So when we look at this passage, there are several things going on in this passage in Exodus 24, just in these few verses, 12 to 18. And the first thing is God told Moses to come. God tells us to come. He called Moses up into the mountains. He called him to a place where it would be up high, where God is, where God dwells. You know, I hear many people who like dwelling in the mountains and go skiing and go up in the mountains and camping say that that's really where God is, because the air is thin, it's clear, and you know you can see all over the place where God wants us to be. I challenge us today that we can dwell in the mountains if we open our spiritual eyes and we can see those mountaintop experiences that God calls us to. But he calls us to the mountain so that he can talk to us. He called Moses up into the mountain because he needed to put him on the right path. He needed to give instruction because Moses was leading the people, God's people. He had led them out of Egypt. He had led them across the Red Sea, and they were still mumbling and complaining. Sounds a lot like us. He leads us to a place that we can flourish, and because it didn't come when we wanted it and how it we wanted it and just, you know, the way that we wanted things, we didn't have all the things in life that we wanted, we find something to complain about except for expressing our gratitude for the things that we came out of. You know, we forget about where we just came from when God has led us to a safe space. And so he called Moses up to the mountain so that he could give him the laws. He could give him the tablets. He could give him the instructions that we are still supposed to be following today. You know, I hear a lot of people say, oh, that was for the old people. That was for back then. The Ten Commandments are not for us. We're in a new age. No, we're not. We are in a new age, but God's law is God's law. He was real clear on what he told Moses to let us know. And so Moses went up into the mountain and the cloud came down. It kind of felt like that when I was in that snowstorm. God slowed me down. God will take us in the midst. He'll rise us up in a situation and he'll take us in the midst of something so that we can calm ourselves down, you know, so that we can get out of this rat race called life, that we can step away from chaos. I encourage each and every person that, you know, find that place that feels like your mountaintop where you can go and it's just you and God. And God can talk to you and God can clear up the chaos and the confusion that might be letting you stay in the midst of something. I've shared before with you that, you know, sometimes when I'm in the midst of some kind of trial that I'm going through, I always go and I ask God, you know, can you make it clear? You know, can you shout if you need to? Because sometimes I'm a little bit hard-headed and it's not clear to me. So can you get the wax and the roadblocks out of my ears and out of my mind that are standing in the way? I would suggest that the complaining that the people were doing were clouding up Moses' ability to hear directly from God sometimes. So God told Moses, come on up to the mountain and tarry with me. And then he dropped the cloud down. He also told him, leave the rest of the folks down the mountain. It's just me and you, Moses. How many times can we think in our daily walks or over our lifetime, God has said, I just want to talk to you. I just want to get your attention. I just need you to leave your family over to the side and take a drive and come with me and let's go to the brook. And then he sets us in a space where everything else seems to disappear. All the distractions, everything that will call us away from that It's just you and me, God says. In the midst of my drive to Chicago on that night, I know that God was with me because there were semis that were flying past me, and I couldn't understand, if I couldn't see, why they were going so fast, because surely I didn't think they could see either. And in the midst of that drive, by the time I got to Michigan City and it was all clear, I knew what my assignment would be when I got to Chicago. See, God had to slow me down. He had to let me know that there was indeed terror on every side as those other cars and those semis were coming by. I don't know about you, but when you were in the midst of a situation you were trying to figure out, were things coming by you on every side that were distractions that kept you from getting to your answer, getting to your destination, that were roadblocks and they were all kinds of things that would pull you away from making a decision? God calls us. He says, come to me, and I'll put you in a space where it's just me and you that we can talk, and I'll give you instructions. See, that's what happened with Moses up on the mountain. God called him up. He left the people. He left Aaron and Hur. He told Aaron and Hur, if there's anything going on, you guys deal with it. And then he left Joshua, and he went up into that mountain by himself. Now, I can only imagine that some of us, because some of the things that we go through in life are so overwhelming, that sometimes we get afraid to have that direct conversation with God. Because he might tell us about ourselves and tell us how we've not been making the right decision, or we've done some things that if we had not done them, we would be so much further down the road. God has a way of separating us and then putting us in that safe space. So Moses went up and he was in the cloud, and he and God, he was there for 6 days. And what does that mean? Because on the seventh day, God spoke to him. On the seventh day, what did God do? See, all of this is tied into creation. On the sixth day, he created man. And so 6 days, Moses was dealing with his humanity. Moses had on the cloak of humanity, but on that seventh day, God said, okay, we're going to work this out. Here's my laws. Here's what you need to do. Here's what you need to do when you go down the mountain and you see the people. Now, we all know the other side of the story, because while he was up in the mountain, the people were down in the valley building the Tower of Babel. They were doing all kinds of things that had nothing to do with their salvation and their freedom. See, they and we as human beings get caught up in worldly things so that we don't have to deal with the trials. They didn't have to deal with, they were partying and having all kinds of fun and figured out, well, God hasn't delivered, so we're going to figure out, we'll worship another God in the meantime. We'll get this done with some other things that the world has us to offer. We'll take our gold and melt it down and build us another God. Sometimes that's what we do. But as Moses was up there shedding and transforming his humanness, and God came and spoke to him and gave him the tablets, he was also being fortified. He was also being transformed and translated so that when he came down, he was being prepared. Well, what does that mean for us today? When we're going through and God gives us a time to separate from the chaos and the confusion of the world, and we get to step aside and sit down and just be in prayer and meditation and studying his word, God gives us a roadmap out, because that separation is strengthening us for what we're going to face when we come out of that meditation. You know, how many of us have gotten on the other side of that trial and found out there are even more trials? There are even more things that you have to deal with. There are even more than when you went up that I have to deal with. You know, it's like the ebb and tides of life. Soon as you get over one hurdle, here comes something else. And when you get over that hurdle, here comes something else. But God, I say, has a wonderful sense of humor. Might not feel awful funny to us, but God is preparing us for the next. Because how many of us can reflect on things that we went through and then somebody showed up in our life and we could share with them how we made it, how we were able to fix that, or how we were able to support somebody, or how we got a bill paid, or how we got food on the table, or how we had so much abundance we were able to take it over to a shelter and spread it around to some other people, that we could spread the joy, because we know that everything has a season. Everything has a time frame. And it won't always be rough. It won't always be overwhelming. It won't always be hard to figure out. Because we can step back like Moses. We can go up into that mountain. We can go into our secret place with God. And we can be fortified, and he'll give us that roadmap. And if we would just follow it, we would find ourselves getting out of situations much more quickly than we have in the past. But there were other things that were going on. The people down in the valley who were sitting, or supposed to be sitting, watching for Moses' return, could look up to the top of the mountain and see a fire. Can you imagine that your leader is gone up into the mountain, and he's been up there for 40 days, and you see a big fire? We make up a lot of stories about what we see when we look up, what we see when we're looking at the future, that fire is destroying poor Moses. Poor Moses says something to God, and he's done. God has had enough of Moses, and he's taking care of him. And there are folks that have that story. But then as God's people, when we see fire, we know that it's the Holy Spirit cleansing all those things that were roadblocks and empowering us. That the fire in the Spirit of the Holy Spirit that represents fire, represents strength, represents cleansing, represents transformation. And so there were those who looked up into the mountains. I can imagine the elders and the priests who were among the people looked up and saw that fire and said, oh, when he comes down, there's going to be a change. We might as well get ready for it. Because when Moses comes, he's coming because he's been touched by the Holy Spirit. How many of us have really experienced the fire of the Holy Spirit in the midst of something that was devastating, in the midst of when you thought all things were lost? You filled up with some power and some energy, and you went out there and you tackled that problem, you overcame it, and you were standing there saying, okay, who's next? Who's coming next? I got this one, and I got some more power left for what else is coming. Because God, in his holiness, in his Holy Spirit, has fired us up. He has charged us up. And then, here's the thing. Maybe you were by yourself when it started. But by the time you got midway or half, three-quarters of the way, other people saw the fire in you, and they saw the energy in you, and they said, I want to be a part of that. I want to join that. Whatever it is you got, I want some of that. And then you find yourself with people who want to be mentored by you, people who want to connect with you and collaborate with you, and they want to go out and feed the hungry and clothe the naked, and they want to lift up somebody in a nursing home, and they want to just get out here and be fired up, running for the Lord. That's what the Holy Spirit does for us. That's what happened when God came down and Moses stepped into that cloud. He was refreshed, restored, renewed, revived, powered up. It's like And the blessings began to come down as you sing your praises, because the fire was seen by the people of Israel. 40 days and 40 nights. So what I know from a clinical standpoint, and what some of you know from a medical standpoint and, you know, educational standpoint, in 40 days, we change. We renew. Our bodies, our cells are renewed. So after Moses' 40 days, he came out a new creature. So in 40 days from today, we could be all brand new. If we commit and we get with God and we separate, and I'm not saying we all have to spend 40 days in solitude, but we can spend 40 days doing something different and asking God for a change and a renewal and a transformation. Because God is able to do anything he wants when we submit ourselves and follow what he says. And so, God is calling us to come up. Come up out of our stories that we tell ourselves. Oh, I'm not good enough. I'm not able to do that. I'm not smart enough. I'm not pretty enough. God is saying, come up out of that. Come up out of what you're not and say, I'm a child of the Most High God. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords loves me, and he has made me and given me the opportunity to do all things through Christ Jesus. Because before Jesus left, he guaranteed that a comforter was coming. And the comforter did arrive. And we've been empowered individually and collectively to do all things that God has assigned us to do. That before we were born, he already gave us an assignment, and he's already equipped us. And so God is saying, come up to me that you might need to be recharged. You know, our batteries run low sometimes because we're bombarded by chaos and confusion of the world. When we wake up in the morning, we might wake up feeling absolutely wonderful. And then when we step out into the house and turn on the TV, and some of us are unfortunate enough to think we need to turn on the news, and then there goes the day. Because there's no good news on the TV station. But there is good news in the Word of God. And so I encourage each and every one of us, when we get up in the morning, open the good news and read from the good news and figure out what good news you can spread from the good news in the day. How can you encourage yourself in the Word of God? Because one way to do it is just flip open the Bible and read wherever it is opens up. Because sometimes that's what you need to do, because that's where your word is. Sometimes some of us need a roadmap, and so we might need to be in Psalms daily and be encouraged by the Psalms. Some of us need to be in Proverbs so we can be corrected as we go along in our day. Some of us need to understand Genesis and the creation, that we were created in the image of God. So we need to be reminded to come up to his word, come up, get up and pick up his word and leave the TV and the news channel off, because it is really devastating to hear some things early in the morning when we have the good news sitting close by us. And if you don't have it close by you in a book, most of everyone I know has a cell phone. And you can ask Siri to give you a scripture for the day, a word for the day. Because, you know, somebody thought well enough to make that available 100% of the time. Siri has never failed. Siri, I think you need to give me a word for this situation. Can you give me a word for anger? Can you give me a word for comfort? And Siri will give you a list. You can read through the whole list or just pick one or two of those verses. But Siri is available for those on iPhone. Now, I don't know about Android, but I know that my pastor has Android and he goes to some other voice that tells him and gives him his information. We even had a war at our church, that the iPhone against the Android. Yes, we did. We use, you know, because we got young people and they tell us we don't know what we're doing. And in my case, they're right. But that's why they were born, to show us. Amen. And so the Lord requires much of us. The Lord requires that we stay involved, that we come up, that we separate ourselves, that we come and let him put us in his cloud of protection, that he, in that time that we tarry with him, that he blocks out all the distractions, and while he helps us transform in our humanness, and he gives us new energies and new insights, and takes out some of the stuff that is roadblocks to what we need to be doing, when he lifts that cloud, when he allows us to come out of that closet, when we step away from our secret place, we're equipped for whatever's coming. And the great thing about the God we serve is, imagine when Moses came down out of that mountain. He first met his priest, his armor bearer, his Joshua, to walk with him. And he had to notice, wow, this isn't the same guy that I walked and he left me sitting here waiting on him. This isn't the same man. Something has changed. How many of us in our walk of life have met folks that we grew up with and they say, you know, you really are different. There's something about you that's really different. You're not the same that you used to be. What have you been doing? Say, oh, I've just been hanging out with God. I've been hanging out with the Most High, and he has blessed me more than that. In fact, let's sit down and let me tell you about it. See, our testimony is what gets others and draws others, because somebody wants to be with you when you're beaming. Nobody wants to hang out with you when you're dredging through life. They want to see us beaming. And we get those beams when we tarry with God. You know, I've been through the beat down stage. I've been at a stage where people's like, no, you don't want to be with her. No, don't call her up because, you know, her conversation is real depressing. No, mm-mm. And then they would see that when they saw me after I submitted, after I surrendered, put two hands in the air and told God, okay, I'm done. I'm done with being me. Can you rescue me? And folks will say, you really look different. What did you do? Oh, I start going to church. I start reading the word. I start praying. I start giving my life over. I started serving. I started doing things God created me to do. And life is just wonderful. But the fair warning is that it's not always going to be wonderful, because God is still refining us. God is still taking us through. And so sometimes we have to go back in that closet. Sometimes we have to find our secret place. Sometimes we have to get down on our face and ask God to help me, because I don't know what this is, but what I do know is I don't want to be in it. Help me out of this spot. But God has already brought us so far that we have reference that he's going to get us out of the new space. He's going to take us into places that we may not even expect. He's going to open doors for us. So when we go through something, when we face something, when people are complaining all around us, when they're doing what they want to do, when they haven't gotten on your last nerves or have gotten on your last nerves, go to God. Come up to him. Let him surround you with his glory and with his message. Let his Holy Spirit fill you up and strengthen you to carry you to the next phase. And I guarantee you that whatever he does is way more than what we can do on been a situation that God hasn't carried me through. I remember on my worst day that I thought was my worst day, when they called me in and said, you know, we don't have enough money to pay you, so your job is being eliminated. Thank you. Goodbye. I was like, really? Wow. I had some other plans. None of them were called unemployment. But that turned into the greatest blessing that I've had and I have had. Because my granddaughter had been born. And mom was going back to work and dad was already at work and they were looking for somebody to watch the baby. I raised two hands and started dancing because I could hang out with my granddaughter. And I spent a whole summer hanging out with her because I wasn't really worried. The mortgage was paid, the car notes were paid, the bills were paid. God had put me in a space preparing me for what folks said was tragedy. God turned it around and made it wonderful. So whatever comes up in your life that looks like a tragedy, look to God because he has other plans. There is always a silver lining, a gold lining, a God lining in every situation. There's something for us to learn in every situation, in every trial and tribulation. God has a miracle waiting just for us. It might not feel good at the moment, but God turns it around. And just like when the people looked up, some of them looked up and said, Moses is done in. And then some of them looked up and said, look at what God is doing. So when Moses arrived back at the camp, he had the rules and regulations. He cleared the way, and people had to turn their lives around. I encourage us just to come up to where God is called.